Okay, so welcome to today's morning session. And so we will start with Professor Gerard Hooft. Welcome. So the title has disappeared. It's BH mechanism for the four forces.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy to have been invited here. Is the microphone on? And to have been invited here in honor of Robert Braut. I did not know Robert very well. I met him just a few times, but I do remember that he was a softly spoken, very friendly person. And of course, the work that he did with Englert in particular had a very lasting effect on particle physics. It's actually difficult to imagine that that there were days when mathematical ideas of that sort, symmetries and breakdown of symmetries, were thought to be esoteric. Has nothing to do with the real world. The real world contains particles that say click in a detector. I still remember Veltman emphasizing that at the time, that you should remember you have fancy mathematical theories, but in reality, it's about what a detector says when a particle goes through. It says click, and that's what you have to remember. And now, since that time, there have been many theories around, and there were theories saying that this whole idea of the Braut-Englert-Higgs mechanism, it's now called, wasn't called that at the time. The different names by whoever, whichever paper you happen to have read. But there were times when these ideas were thought very esoteric, and above all, they were also thought to be mathematically wanting. There was something wrong, because they were powerful mathematical theorems. Now, I have a theorem about theorems, in particular theorems in physics. And that is that all these beautiful theories, when someone says you can't do this or you can't do that, then and it's based on a theorem, someone has proved that you can't do this or you can't do that. Well, as soon as you say that in mathematics, then maybe, okay, then the theorem is wrong and you have to forget it. But in physics, the situation is much more subtle. If someone tells you it has been proven that something cannot be done, then the only thing you have to do is look at the small print. Look at the conditions. It's like a contract that says under certain such conditions, this or that cannot be done. What the author really means, that cannot be done the way he had thought it should be done. So, and this is a particular hold also for theories that told us that the Braut-Englert-Higgs mechanism couldn't work. And it went all back to Jeffrey Goldstone, who wrote about a theorem. He had written a theorem that says when symmetries are spontaneously broken, then you must have massless particles. One species of particle for every spontaneously broken symmetry generator. And and the next question was when Higgs and Braut and Englert and also several other people at the same time, Guralnik, Hagen, and Kibble, when they all came with these ideas about spontaneous symmetry breakdown, the response they got, well, we have a theorem saying this cannot be done. It's called the Goldstone theorem. So something is wrong because these theories are not talking about massless particles. And we know that massless particles of that kind that you're talking about here do not exist in nature, only badly broken ones, such as the pion is considered a very light particle because it's nearly a Goldstone particle. So there you see that a theorem works. The pion has its mass just because there's also an explicit breakdown of the symmetry on which it is based. And so this should hold for all the other theories as well. And this is wrong. But in the case of Goldstone, it was erroneously thought that a theorem should apply to the Braut-Englert-Higgs mechanism because the symmetry is spontaneously broken. And therefore, such theories had to contain massless particles. But the assumptions were wrong in two ways. One was that Goldstone's theorem as it turned out, and it was emphasized by Goldstone, but only sort of in a footnote, that his theorem only applies if the forces are strictly local. And then he adds, of course, electromagnetism is a non-local force. But you can also say, well, what do you mean by that? If you can still write down Maxwell's equations, they look fairly local to me. So why do you say that electromagnetism is non-local? And the answer is, well, because there are massless particles, the photons, and that he hadn't considered in his theorem, that interactions could be long range because of massless particles. And then it all falls flat on its face. But the theorem was so beautifully formulated that everybody thought, well, that's just a detail, and that's a small print, and forget about it. But of course, that was the whole point, that in the case of electromagnetism, you don't have a global symmetry, but you have a local symmetry, and that makes a huge difference in all these theorems. The second, more subtle mistake which was made was the idea that the Braut, what you now call Braut-Englert-Higgs mechanism, would be a spontaneously broken symmetry. Actually, strictly speaking, that is not true at all. You can't even talk about a global symmetry being spontaneously broken in the case of BEH. That's a common misunderstanding. But it so happened that people thought this, and because of this, the burden of proof that the theories were useful anyway were put upon all these people, Braut, Englert, Higgs, Guralnik, Hagen, Kibble, and other people who worked these theories. They all were laughed upon, because they should prove why there are no Goldstone particles. And the reason why Braut-Englert-Higgs is not spontaneous symmetry breaking is a very subtle one. Because if you look at the mathematical formulation of the Lagrangian in particular, you have two important parameters in the Lagrangian: the self-interaction of the Higgs field, what you now call the Higgs field, or Braut-Englert-Higgs field perhaps. The self-interaction could be positive or negative. If it is negative, you have in the global theory spontaneous symmetry breakdown. That is to say, the vacuum is degenerate. There's not one vacuum, but if you make a global transformation, you get a different vacuum. Think of the ferromagnet as a typical example. The ferromagnet is a theory with a global symmetry, just rotation symmetry, but the rotation symmetry is broken. As soon as you have magnetism there, then you have a vacuum state with a magnetization in a z direction. But the magnetization could also be in the x or the y direction or any other direction. And that makes the vacuum state degenerate. And when the vacuum state is degenerate, the symmetry is broken spontaneously. But that holds when you have a global symmetry. If the symmetry is local, something completely different happens. And that's the top line of this graph. It's incomplete. It was just a last minute idea to add this picture. The top line here, the symmetry is, on the left, it is a global symmetry, which is, you could call spontaneously broken in the global theory. So at the left, it's spontaneously broken. At the right, when you have a gauge field coupled to that symmetry, for instance, electric charge, it could be any other non-Abelian theory or Abelian theory, where the electric charge is different from zero, there the symmetry is not spontaneously broken at all. In fact, there is that symmetry needs not be there at all. So it's a very, very different situation. Amazingly, however, when you do the mathematics, you can take the e to zero limit and the lambda to zero limit, and then you find that these limits all obviously commute in the calculations. And so on the lower line, I wanted to write just a symmetric version of the theory where the symmetry is not broken either spontaneously or any other way. And there, the limit is straightforward. Now, why is this subtle situation? It all has to do with infrared divergences. If you have a local symmetry, you have massless photons. These massless photons generate infrared divergences. And in the so-called naive calculation that you do here, just a perturbation expansion, nothing else, you just ignore the very soft photons and then you can do all the calculation you want to do. And it seems as if these limits commute, but if you're more careful, you find that conceptually what happens is something much more subtle. In the case of the ferromagnets, if you couple that to a local symmetry, then the vacuum would suddenly, as soon as E would be different from zero, the vacuum would no longer be degenerate. That would be only one vacuum state. The vacuum would be gauge invariant. So in the Brown-Englert-Higgs mechanism, always the vacuum is gauge invariant. There is no infinity of vacuum states. There's only one vacuum state. Where does this difference come from? And the argument is easy to identify. It is because of there's an observer at infinity, and you ask for the magnetization in the magnet as seen by an observer at infinity. But if you leave the observer at infinity in its place, but you rotate the magnet, you get different physical states because it's a global symmetry only. But in the case of a local symmetry, that's the same state. So there is a stepwise difference between the global and the local symmetry. That is difficult to explain, but it all comes back in the infrared divergences. There was a beautiful talk by Andy Strominger only a few weeks ago in Argentina, which I happened to attend, where he explained that strictly speaking, there is no infrared divergence either in electromagnetism, but you have to carefully look at how to do the limit that E goes to zero. That's a much more subtle procedure than one normally does, and that makes all the difference. So you have the role of the observer, you have the infrared divergences, which all tell you that, strictly speaking, when you talk about these theories, the spontaneous symmetry breaking does not occur in a Brown-Englert-Higgs theory. But since when you do easy calculations for undergraduate students and the like, you just ignore all that, and then it all looks like the same thing. So this was another source of the apparent contradictions with Goldstone's theorems. So today, the Brown-Englert-Higgs mechanism is everywhere in particle physics, and not only in the electroweak case. So now it is unthinkable to understand particle physics properly without understanding this mechanism. So let me begin with quantum electrodynamics. Of course, that is a theory that where the vacuum in particle physics is completely symmetric. So we have no BEH mechanism in quantum electrodynamics. But of course, you can also consider electromagnetism within materials, and there you can have superconductivity. And this is actually one of the first ways in which the mechanism was understood properly. In a superconductor, the photon becomes short range. The photon gets a mass, and also the behavior of electromagnetic field becomes totally different. There is a typical BEH mechanism taking place in a superconductor. The consequences are rather peculiar, that not only does the photon become massive so that there is no longer any electric field, any long-range electric field present in a superconductor, but also magnetic fields get a very different behavior. The magnetic field lines are also not smoothly distributed, but they condensate into vortices. These vortices are, again, nowadays very essential to understand both superconductivity, but also particle physics. These vortices will come back. And the consequence of these vortices is that if you would put a magnetic monopole, don't care where it comes from, just assume that someone made the magnetic monopole. If you put a magnetic monopole inside a superconductor, it will be forced out immediately because it will be connected to a vortex and in some direction, and that vortex will pull the monopole out of the superconductor. So today, these features are very well understood, and they are fundamental in the Brown-Englert-Higgs mechanism in electro-like theory. So in abelian gauge theories, this is what happens. But the main example where it caused a lot of commotion was the electroweak theory. The electroweak theory, which in the early days was not understood in detail, and it was certainly not believed that spontaneous symmetry breaking, or more precisely, the Brown-Englert-Higgs mechanism, would have anything to do with this force. But as you all know now, I hope, historically, these models were proposed first in a somewhat clumsy way. It wasn't quite understood where the mass of the W bosons came from and the Z bosons, but later it was understood that's the BEH mechanism. And now we understand how to describe these things properly. What we have in all these cases is you have a large gauge group G, which is broken down either completely or partially into a smaller gauge group G1. G1 could be just the identity, but it could also be a group. And then the G1 is a lower symmetry, therefore has fewer generators. The dimension of the group G1 is smaller than G. And so the difference in dimensions is a number of basically massless particles that you generate in a global symmetry, or it would be the number number of massive photons that you get in the global, in the local symmetry. So in the case of local symmetry, as you know, several bosons or gauge bosons generate a mass. And we now understand that that happens because they turn from massless spin one to into a massive spin one. A massive spin one field has 1 degree of freedom more than a massless one. Massless photons have 2 degrees of freedom. Massive spin one particles have 3 degrees of freedom. So where does this 1 degree of freedom come from? Well, that is this Goldstone boson, which just disappeared as soon as your theory became a local symmetry theory. So this is how these two chapters in this slide are all connected, that you have the same situation, but you use different wordings to describe it. And also, physically speaking, you see big differences taking place when this mechanism happens. So anyway, this was the first next non-trivial aspect of the BEH theory that became well understood. And this, as you all know, became a very successful model for the electroweak theory. In a curious way, electromagnetism, that's to say the abelian U1 symmetry theory, became entangled with the SU2 theory, the non-abelian part, so that SU2 cos U1 was broken down to a group G1, which was the U1 theory, but also mixed with a U1 subgroup of the SU2 system. And all this gave the weak interactions their very special nature, like the charged W bosons being somewhat different from the neutral W boson, neutral Z boson, and so on. But this is historically now well understood. The next theory, where also this Brout-Englert-Higgs mechanism became very important, was quantum chromodynamics. And in quantum chromodynamics, the symmetry is always said to be explicit. The SU3 color symmetry is not spontaneously broken, or in better words, not a BEH theory. So you, at first sight, you think that BEH has nothing to do with a strong force. But that is not true, because it turns out that the BEH mechanism is essential in understanding how quark confinement takes place. And suddenly, there's a discrete transition when this coupling constant changes sign for BEH, that the masses of the quarks suddenly becomes infinite. The quarks become confined. And this, to understand this, you have to understand that you have to go to the electric magnetic dual of the theory. And in particular, you can understand that when you consider the center Zn of the color group Sun. In Zn theories, which you can put on a lattice very easily, turn out to become self-dual. So you can exactly go from the theory to the dual theory. That you can do when you use the center of the group. If you use the full gauge group, the duality is much more subtle, and you have to be an expert at supersymmetry to understand how it goes. But if you just go to the center of the group, like I would like to do, it's much easier to understand how it all works. So I have to watch out my time. I'm thinking. Okay, so the theory can come in different phases, and now you have to look at the dual Brout-Englert-Higgs mechanism to see in what phases QCD can be, and then you find that, mathematically speaking, something very, very similar happens, that You have vortices, but the vortices now are not magnetic vortices, but electric vortices. So electric and magnetic are interchanged. So now you have electric vortex lines. So now instead of magnetic monopoles being pushed out of the theory, it's the color charged quarks which are pushed out or connected to an anti-quark, or in a more subtle way, three quarks connected to form a baryonic state. So what happens now is very similar to what happens inside a superconductor, but electricity and magnetism are interchanged. And so we find how BEH actually also is very important to QCD. So QCD turns out to be a theory that can be in different phases, the Brauting-Lehrig-Higgs phase. That would be the ordinary Brauting-Lehrig-Higgs phase, which is not happening in QCD for reasons which can only be understood if you do detailed quantitative calculations. The dual to BEH, that's what I realize in QCD. But you can also have a QED phase where all forces become long range. In principle, QCD could have condensed in this other mode where the strong forces become long range forces. That could have been possible. It isn't our world where QCD is under the dual BEH state. You can actually have combinations of these phases if you take a larger gauge group, if you have gauge groups in different subgroups, where different subgroups could behave in different ways. And then you get a combination of all these phases. Finally, a few words on gravity. You might think that gravity is so remotely different from electromagnetism and from weak forces that there will be no talk of BEH in gravity. Well, actually, the opposite is true. There could be two different ways in which a BEH force can be relevant in gravity. One is, suppose you want to give a mass to the graviton. That's not such a silly question, because the graviton we all believe to be massless. But if you have an effective theory for, again, QCD, in QCD, we like to think of QCD to be a sort of effective string theory. And if it is a string-like theory, there should be closed string solutions. Yes, you have closed string solutions in QCD. They're called glue balls. But no, glue balls are not like gravitons. Certainly, we don't have massless glue balls in QCD. So the question one can ask is, where are the massless glue balls in QCD? And the answer could be, a kind of Brauting-Lehrig-Higgs mechanism is making those gravitons massive. I tried very hard to make such a theory, but I failed in that respect, so it never really caught the headlines in any possible way. There is no Brauting-Lehrig-Higgs mechanism that makes gravitons massive. The reason is, again, this more precise physical interpretation of what BEH really means. You might think that the Poincaré group is a subgroup of the general diffeomorphisms. It's not true. It's much more subtle than that. And that's because we want a theory where the surviving symmetry turns out to be Poincaré symmetry. But that's a global group. And then you have to think very hard about what I said in the beginning of the talk about the difference between BEH and spontaneous symmetry breaking. If it would be just a question of spontaneous symmetry breaking, you might think that the Poincaré group could survive as a symmetry group that after making gravitons massive. But it doesn't work. And one reason is that you're looking at the invariance for the Poincaré group, but you get three positive signs and, of course, a negative sign. This is going to be Lorentz invariance that should survive. But that means you need a Higgs field in gravity with one wrong sign. The time component of that Higgs field is the wrong sign. These would be the four coordinates, but they would act like Higgs fields in the case of a BEH for gravity. It doesn't work because of this minus sign. The starting theory will not be unitary. Unfortunately, one tries to cure the disease, but at least I didn't survive in that. The final thing you can do in gravity, and that does work, is to say that ordinary Einstein-Hilbert gravity is a BEH theory. It is a theory if you split up the metric tensor in terms of a scale factor and the remainder. And the scale factor then scales non-trivially under a conformal symmetry of the fields. And I think my time sort of up, so I won't go into any of these details. I think Dr. Shaposhnikov will talk about scale invariance and whether or not that is a spontaneously broken symmetry. From my point of view, scale invariance is spontaneously broken in a very special way, but more precisely, it is a BEH theory. So then you can say, well, it is spontaneously broken in the sense that BEH reminds one of spontaneous symmetry breaking, but strictly speaking, it is not. The vacuum is not scale invariant, but it is invariant under this transformation. This is a very trivial transformation under which, of course, the theory is invariant because it's my definition that only says that this field, this combination of field, is physically relevant. So, of course, this is a symmetry, a trivial symmetry, under which the vacuum is invariant. So it's this symmetry that undergoes the BEH mechanism for gravity. And this theory, for instance, tells you that if you take the Weyl invariant, the square of the Weyl tensor, if you would add that as a fundamental interaction into gravity, your theory would become renormalizable. The problem with this is that this generates a breakdown of unitarity that is not easy to cure. So yes, you have a renormalizable theory, but no, it's not a unitary theory, so it's not particularly useful for that reason. Okay, there are more things to be said, of course, about this, but I think my time is more than over. So I just want to leave you with the message, BEH is everywhere. Oh, what? I do have more time. I thought my time was over, sort of, but so that's why I was in a hurry. Okay, the lesson I wanted to explain was that BEH is everywhere in particle physics and in quantum gravity. So maybe one thing is, instead of filling another 50 minutes, why not have a discussion?
Yeah, so we can have a... Okay, thank you very much. Okay. So we have time. So we have time for a discussion. Slava.
Gerard, why you say that you failed to make this Braut-Engelhardt mechanism for gravity? Because you wrote paper 2008.
Yes.
Okay, you didn't get Pauli Firth there. This was perhaps that this is the reason why you say that there is ghost in the theory, or why you said that you failed. Because you can make Pauli Firth also. Then there is no linear Boulevard Desert ghost. Then you can remove it. Now it's the whole activity, in fact. With thousands of papers.
Yes.
Okay, because you were the first to use four scalar fields to give mass, right?
Yeah.
But you were getting 6 degrees of freedom, one was ghost degree of freedom. This is the reason why you said that you failed, or what?
Well, yeah, of course you want 6 degrees of freedom in order to get the mass of gravity.
Right, but you can nevertheless find very ugly Lagrangian, and then you can get effectively Pauli Firth. Then you have 5 degrees of freedom.
Yes.
Then there comes next question about nonlinear Boulevard Desert ghost. But even, okay, you can make Lagrangian even more ugly, but remove it in the next order, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And now there is the statement, there is some kind of gravity without this nonlinear Boulevard Desert ghost with a unique Weinstein scale. You didn't follow it.
Well,
this Gabadadze, the Ram.
What happens to the Poincaré group? Because the Poincaré group is a non-compact group. Has not only non-compactness in the direction of the Lorentz transformation, but also in the translation center, of course. So this is a non-compact group. And as I said, in the BEH mechanism,
yeah,
you shouldn't talk about spontaneous symmetry breaking. So it's not true that the diffeomorphism group breaks down into the Poincaré group. That's what you like to think. Mathematically, OK, the group structure is like that. But physically, that's not what happens. The Poincaré group should be put in the original theory. But then you have a non-compact symmetry group. So how can you restore unitarity in that system?
But on the Minkowski background, when you consider linearize the next nonlinear correction, is okay. But for an arbitrary background, of course, you can do nothing because you know that arbitrary background, arbitrary curved background, you will not even find solutions. The notion of graviton mass is, I don't know, lose some in some sense because.
Do you agree that a massive graviton of the kind that occurs in QCD, mind you? That theory still has Poincaré invariance.
Yes, but gravity, by definition, cannot have Poincaré global invariance or for the nonlinear, for the non-trivial background. But in linearized version, it works. Because you were doing linearized version, because actually these kind of fields which you were taking, right, they were proportional to the coordinates.
But when you talk about the linearized theory, that's not really the general theory that you want.
Yeah, but okay.
You want a theory where strings generate something like gravity.
Right.
And then you say, wait a minute, but QCD doesn't contain gravity. So what happened to gravity? What happened to the degrees of freedom in particular?
No, it so be, yeah.
The original theory in its symmetric phase, which had just two gravitons, and then for the rest, massive particles and so on. Two gravitons, two photons perhaps. Look, the photons are much easier to remove by a standard BH mechanism. And you say, okay, I know how to make the photons massive. You're doing it all the time in weak interactions. So, but I find very difficult to make a spin two object massive without my, without seeing what happens to the Poincaré transformation. So you need to be able to make Poincaré transformations. So that's, that in combination with the nonlinear,
is this formulation, okay, problem even cannot be stated because for the generic background, there is no Poincaré group. But if you want, for instance, on Minkowski to get graviton with 5 degrees of freedom with Pauli fields, it's possible. And three scalar fields, okay, are absorbed by gravity. And then actually the impression like you have graviton with 5 degrees of freedom, three scalar field, okay, with right sign give you extra things, and plus 1 degree of freedom remains non-dynamical in principle. But of course, in the universe, this is very ugly Lagrangian with 4 scalar fields, with normal Einstein gravity, and there is no generic solution for the background, which breaks the symmetry.
Why you want this to happen in the universe? I mean, this is for something else. You talk about the different physical framework,
and
I, QCD. But you won't have a similar phenomenon happening in the early universe.
You know, it's impossible because from the very beginning, when you take general relativity, there is no global Poincaré group there for the generic solution. Okay. In this sense, okay.
Can I allow the question? If this discussion finished?
Please.
Yeah. You made a distinction between what was okay for mathematics and what didn't work for physics. Can I suggest that the mathematics is not as simple as you think? And the fundamental reason why gravity is difficult is that whereas the diffeomorphism group of the 2 spheres well understood, the diffeomorphism group of the 3 spheres unsolved. And that is a very simple fact, different dimensions. That is the beginning of a vast amount of work in mathematics, which is exactly the counterpart. And in fact, through string theory, through the work of Zipf-Witten, those things are linked. Donaldson's work is, in fact, about this story. So you can see very clearly that all the problems, all the difficulties of gravity are there present in mathematics, and they're very interesting. They're not dull, not routine, they're totally new phenomena. So that is actually a misconception to think mathematicians are naive and just do the easy problems.
Okay, well, I agree, of course, that gravity is very far away from being solved physically. Or indeed mathematically, and I agree with you that we need very different mathematical starting points. Next week there's the Young Scientists meeting, and I'll try to explain how I think about exactly these problems. And one essential feature there is that you should not ignore black holes. Black holes should actually be a very essential part of physics. Perhaps all particles can be viewed upon as black holes, or maybe just limiting situations. So they're not literally black holes. It would be crazy to say that an electron is an horizon because for various reasons, spin, it all doesn't work. So, but the transition between elementary particles and black holes is very probably a smooth conceptual transition. But that means that black holes are a much more essential object than one can be normally thought of. So you shouldn't put them as an afterthought.
No, I don't agree.
Of course, but that gives you a very different view on gravity, particularly in the case of quantum mechanics, than the normal view. If you just work with classical, with that unquantized gravity, I think we have the situation pretty well under control. Although, as you know, there are extreme cases where people have different opinions, but I think physically understand. You talk about colliding black holes and things like this. We know pretty well how to do calculations. if you say that difficulty is there, I'd like to listen to what you say.
I think mathematicians and physicists do the same thing in different words, and they're equally subtle.
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, so I think this is a relatively minor point, but I just want to make sure that I understand. So this is a relatively minor point, but I just want to make sure I understand the point you have made. So you made a point that the Poincaré group in this context of gravity should not be considered as subgroup of the diffeomorphism. And so I wanted to understand this in the, by considering a relation to the standard, what I consider statement in the case of compact gauge group, in a gauge theory with compact gauge group, where I thought that there is a non-normalizable part of the gauge symmetry, which is a group G, which appears as global symmetry, but when G is spontaneously broken by BEH mechanism, this non-normalizable part also becomes invisible. So for example, in the standard model, we have SU2 crosses U1, and then there is a spontaneous symmetry breaking, and then non-U1 part would not be visible, even including non-normalizable part. So should I not think of a Poincaré group as non-normalizable part of a diffeomorphism group?
In the BEH mechanism, typically in the electrical weak case, what happens is that you start a theory that has a global symmetry, which may or may not be broken, actually. So for instance, this Higgs field is a two complex component spin one half, isospin one half field. So there's four real components that has a hidden SO4 symmetry in its Lagrangian. And that is the global symmetry that survives after the BEH mechanism. Because after BEH mechanism, you have still symmetry between electrons and neutrinos. They form doublets.
Okay.
And the symmetry only slightly
right.
broken.
Yeah, yeah.
Because actually it's not an SU2 theory, but SU2 cross U1 theory, and the global the vector is no longer exactly on a global SU2 cross U1, but it has some global SU2 structure. But that is the structure of the underlying theory. Even the symmetric theory has global and local symmetry.
Yes.
Local symmetry as usual, but there's also a global symmetry that's distinct from the local symmetries that you normally couple to gauge particles. Same thing in gravity, that the Poincaré group, although you can consider it as a subgroup of the general coordinate transformation, what you have in reality is that what we want is a BEH mechanism where the Poincaré group is mixed with a subgroup of the general coordinate transformations, but you need a theory that starts off with a Poincaré invariance as well. And that was the difficulty that I had disputed with Slava Mukanov about the original theory that is demanded to have a Poincaré invariant set of fields. And that's hard because the Poincaré group is not compact, whereas all symmetry that you can use in a unitary theory, and I underline unitary, means that you are only allowed to have compact field theories, so non-space time theories, in your underlying theory. Before the BEH mechanism takes place, you have the symmetric modal theory. That symmetric Lagrangian must have already visible in it a Poincaré symmetry. And that is my difficulty with trying to generate that mechanism in gravity.
Thank you. So do I understand it correctly, therefore, that the issue you pointed out in Poincaré group versus diffeomorphism also exists in the case of compact gauge group? Because you started your answer by discussing the case of compact gauge group, where
yes.
distinction has to be made.
Right.
Between the global symmetry and the local symmetry. The purpose of my question was that, so you pointed out in the case of gravity, there are some issues with proposal for spontaneous symmetry breaking of Poincaré group. And this point about the distinction between Poincaré group and diffeomorphism group actually not specific feature of gravity, but also exists already in the case of compact group. Do I understand it correctly?
I think so, yes.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yes.
Are there other questions? If not, let's thank the speaker again.